Hey there, welcome. My name is Lou Diamond, speaker, consultant, podcaster, and author of Speak Easy. You know, in the original Speak Easies, it was real important to stay very quiet so the police couldn't hear where your clandestine special nightclub was. Well, here, at this Speak Easy, we encourage conversations. You see, I believe that every connection begins with a great conversation. In fact, at this establishment and in my book, Speak Easy, I put together the tips, tricks, techniques, blends, mixtures, and concoctions that you need to make more of your conversations great. Whether you're a professional looking to grow your business, a leader looking to connect your people, or an individual looking to grow your own personal connections, the lessons you'll learn in Speak Easy will help you connect, engage, and win in all of your conversations.
Because the house always wins. Play long enough, you never change the stakes. The house takes you, unless when that perfect hand comes along, you bet and you bet big. Then you take the house. Oh, and thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Would you like to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Speak Easy and master connector Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on this planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another spectacular episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond, and today on Thrive Loud, we have a strategist, consultant, coach, speaker, trainer, author, and podcaster. He's also the founder of the Superhero Institute. I kid you not, he literally has the Hall of Justice in his home. A coaching certification program specializing in a methodology that unleashes human potential in service of making the world a safer, kinder, and more equitable place. His unbelievable book, The Lovable Leader, Build Great Teams with Trust, Respect, and Kindness, is an amazing book you must pick up, which we'll provide all the links for in the show. And we're going to feature it in a mashup here with Speak Easy, as in the Speak Easy Lovable Leader mashup program here on Thrive Loud. I bring you the author of Lovable Leader, the amazing Jeff Gibbard.
Hey,
Jeff,
man.
How are you today?
What is up, Lou? That is undoubtedly, undeniably, the best intro I've ever gotten on any podcast. And I mean, I expected no less, but
of course,
you delivered the goods.
I had to deliver, and what most of the listeners won't know is that I messed up in the beginning, but that's not important right now.
It doesn't matter. I didn't even remember that. It's all gone for me.
It's all gone.
Yeah.
First of all, thank you for coming on Thrive Loud today. I want to bring our listeners up to speed and give a little bit of background as to who this superhero I'm chatting with is. And the way I usually do this on the program, Jeff, because you're a professional podcaster at extreme levels, like you cannot believe, and we'll talk about that. I'm going to do a little rewind here. I don't want to go all the way back to the womb. Just too scary for both of us at this moment.
Absolutely.
What I do want to do is understand how the thing that you're doing now became your gig.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to go real far back, but I'm going to make it real fast, though, is the whole superhero thing actually did start when I was a kid. I grew up. I was born shortly after the first Superman came out and right before the second Superman came out. Huge kid that loves Superman. I was like all about it. It was every day in every way. So that kind of anchored me from a very early age in being about using your powers for good in the world. So fast forward, throughout my life, my dad was a funeral director. He told me, you know, find something you love to do so you don't spend all of your day burying people. And I was like, okay, thanks. I'm seven. So I'm going throughout my life trying to find these things that I'm passionate about, these things that I'm all about. And I, you know, followed one thing after another. I tried to be a professional basketball player, tried to be a Hollywood director, tried to be a professional photographer, a professional chef. I had all these different things that I was following my different passions. And it wasn't until fast forward, I graduated my MBA in my early 30s. And I got fired from a PR company that I was at. I am a terrible employee, just cards on the table. I'm psychologically unemployable. Doesn't work. But I started my agency, True Voice Media, which was a social media agency. I ran it for 7 years. And I thought it was going to bring the world together and make it a more harmonious place, the whole social media thing. Turns out, ripped apart the fabric of society. And I found myself about a decade after starting in the world of social media that I just wanted nothing more to do with it. And in that hiatus, my wife said something to me that at first I dismissed. She was like, why don't you do something with superheroes? And I was like, that's ridiculous. No one in business will ever take me seriously if I just talk about superheroes. That's ridiculous. Thank you. I love you, honey. You're the best. Went off and I talked with a number of our mutual friends, a number of people that I really respect, authors, speakers, coaches, people that have been living their dreams. And the thing that kept coming up time and time again was about this love of helping people find their superpowers, helping people unleash their potential, and really pointing it towards making the world a better place. And I had to go back, tail tucked between my legs to my wife and said,
You're right.
Which, you know, if you're in a partnership, you know that nobody loves that more than your partner. So she was right. And since then I've been just working on fusing that into every part of what I do. And it's been the easiest transition of my career to make that positioning and that whole way of doing things work.
I'm going to ask this question. And by the way, we're from the same ilk. I'll, at the end of this program, I promise you to give you something that you're going to love about Superman, because a little older than you are, but still very similar and very much an important part of my whole being, which is probably why you're a big Seinfeld fan, I imagine, as well, who was a huge Superman fan.
Huge Superman fan.
I want to talk about this part about the superheroes, because I agree with you. I agree that unleashing these powers is very important and such an important aspect of business. Can we talk about, while you had resistance in recognizing that nobody would go do this, and then you started marketing and realizing this was the thing to do, let's talk about the hurdles that you faced and the initial doubts that you were hit with from leaders, from companies, when they're looking at the Superhero Institute. Because I guarantee you, the same initial hesitation that you had was something that they probably held back. I want to talk about some of that resistance that you originally received.
You know, I don't recall too much pushback, to be honest. In fact, I think I underestimated how much there is a kid inside all of us that wants to talk about all of this stuff, that appreciated my enthusiasm, my authenticity around this stuff. I mean, for God's sakes, I'm sitting in a Spider-Man chair. You know, I live this stuff. I wear superhero t-shirts every day, and just except for today, it's Daddy Daughter Day. I'm wearing a panda. But
that might
I
be
underestimated.
Yeah.
What was that?
That might be her superhero, the panda.
So she loves Spider-Man. She's just like me. So I underestimated how much people were really going to be into this thing. They really took to it. And I think it's because I wasn't framing it as like, hey, let's geek out and let's talk about like why Batman is so cool. But instead, I started applying the lessons and the things that I saw in superheroes. And really, I think everybody has a little bit of a power fantasy of like being their best version of themselves and being able to go out there and accomplish the things that they want to. So I did not find very much. And the other thing is that this was a continuation of a theme that I had picked up on several years earlier in my career, which is that being distinctive, being memorable goes a really long way. So for a while, my LinkedIn headline was the world's most handsome social media and content marketing strategist. And I kid you not, that got me like 10 years of people coming out of the woodwork to talk to me because they were like, what is that about? Are you joking? Are you being like, you know, serious? Like, what's your thing? And so between that, wearing red sneakers, the superhero thing, like I've always found a way that people are like, oh, you need to go talk to Jeff. He's fill in the blank, the guy with the red sneakers, the superhero guy, you know, the most handsome social media strategist.
Which is accurate, as the listeners watching the video feeds of this can say, this is the most handsome podcaster social media dude out there, without a doubt.
I don't know what you're laughing about. Yeah, I retain the title.
I want to jump to this really quickly. What's your superpower?
I think my superpower is, God, it's tough because I actually would point to a couple of them. But if I had to pick out the one, is I think I help people see that they're capable of more, and I give them the tools to do it. So I think that that's my ultimate superpower. I had a friend that asked me the question, and I responded, and I said something. He said that he thinks that my superpower is resilience, is reinvention, because he knows a lot about my story and different things that have happened in my life that I bounced back from and I reinvented myself. So he replied that he thought it was resilience and reinvention. And I like that. But I tend to try and also think of my superpower in service of others. So when I think about my superpower in service of others, it is helping people to feel like they have the permission to do what it is that they want to do in life, that they have the ability to do it, that they're good enough, they're smart enough, they're kind enough, whatever it might be, and that the tools are there for them to go and do it. So I think that that's really my superpower.
The lovable leader. I will share with you that when I first learned about the book, I went and read like your bio and blurb about the book and to hear the angle that it went into. And there was a lot, even in just the general description of what the book was about, that I said, oh, this is a good tactic. And I think it's a really interesting one because I think a lot of people don't associate those two words together so often. There's this vision of leadership, and I'll even use superheroes in that regard, right? Sure, we love superheroes, but somehow we look at them as some form of leader. But we're not always saying, oh, that's the lovable superhero. We're usually highlighting more of their superpower and maybe their kindness or whatever afterwards. You're bringing these two together. Can I ask what spawned the idea of the lovable leader and how that became a real summary of what really makes great superhero leaders?
Yeah. And it's funny because as you were saying that, you actually triggered a thought for me that I hand to God, did not think of until you just mentioned this. But when we overlay lovable leadership over superheroes, I honestly hadn't really made too much of that overlay in terms of lovable leader and superhero, but the three core tenets of lovable leadership are care, trust, and safe travels. And what those three things mean are that we have leaders that we know care about us, we have leaders that we trust, and we have leaders who will provide safety for us on the way to a big and ambitious goal. That's the three pillars of lovable leadership. And I think if you look at any superhero that we admire, we tend to sense that they care about us, because why else would they be saving us from whatever, you know, I'm talking fiction, obviously. We have to trust that they're going to show up in our time of need. And at the same time, they're also going to make sure that we're safe to go where we're trying to go. So I really think there is an overlap there. As far as where it kind of came from, like what inspired this book, I'm completely honestly, the book was inspired almost entirely by my wife. She had been just promoted to a role where she was managing for the first time. And we were driving back from a vacation with some friends. She was asking me all these questions about, you know, managing people because I'd been doing it for a while. So I just started giving her some advice. And, you know, we still do these coaching talks basically every morning on our way to work. But what I noticed was I was giving her different like tactical advice, like here's how to have this powerful conversation. Here's how to do this. But there was a sort of an X factor that was unspoken about, but that was in her, that I think was the thing that made all the difference. And that was the fact that no matter what, she is lovable. She's a lovable person because she's kind, because she cares about people. You know you can trust her. She's like Girl Scout honest. And you know that if she can make you feel safe, if she can provide safety for you, she's going to do it. But she also has high standards, high expectations, so she's going to push you to do more. So really, the book is in so many ways an ode to my wife and her style. I've just really filled it out with a lot more of the theory and philosophy of all sorts of other different influences, such as, you know, like things like Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People. There's things there about, you know, the science and of influence and persuasion. So there's a lot of different things that I brought into there. But really, if you look at like what was the spark? The spark was I have a lovable wife who is managing people for the first time. She's a new manager. I wanted to write a book for new managers who she was really good at a thing, but she didn't know how to manage people specifically. So I had to give her some of those tools. So I wanted to write it as like a handbook for her.
Nice. Listeners need to know we're about 11 some odd minutes into the podcast. We've already given Jeff's wife two shout outs and kudos in the episode. So
she's going to ask about it. So
yeah, she will. And thought we got her in the beginning. We hit her right around the middle, and we're definitely going to have to thank her at the end. So a certain author opposite you in this thing has just written a book called Speak Easy, Connect with Every Conversation. And a lot of the book focuses on how you need to be in entering a conversation. Can we talk about the importance of conversations as a lovable leader and how important trust, respect, and kindness is in the conversations you have as a leader with your team, with your colleagues, with your organization, or externally for whatever it might be? How important is that in your conversations, in your mind?
Well, I think if you're going to create an environment where care is present, you're going to create an environment where trust is present, and you're going to create an environment where people feel safe to really have the freedom to chase their ambitious goals that you set, then you have to have kindness there. You have to build trust for them to feel the freedom to go forth on that. But I want to actually give a shout out to something that you and I have talked about before that I think is exceptionally important in being able to cultivate that safety, the kindness, the trust, all of those different elements that is going to make for a great conversation. And that's curiosity. I think a really great leader has to be humble enough to not know the answers and to be curious about where people are coming from. There's a concept in the book that I call sitting on the same side of the table. And I would argue that a lot of what you're talking about, a lot of what comes out of How to Win Friends and Influence People, comes out of a lot of books, are making a lot of the same points, which is that you want to be in the same conversation with someone where you're on their side, where you're not trying to invalidate them. You're trying to actually validate them and be looking in the same direction with them. And in order to do that, you really do have to be curious early on in the process. You have to listen to what they're saying and be curious enough to dig deeper to get into what is actually, what are their goals? What are they after? How can you find out the thing that motivates them? And that only comes from curiosity.
And when you use curiosity, I used to use this term connectosity, where you're basically combining your connecting skills and curiosity in conversations, it is piquing not only your own curiosity and understanding what that individual you're trying to connect with is all about, it's also getting the person who's providing the information, the one you're trying to connect to be interested in you as well, because there is this natural component that says this person cares enough genuinely. It's got to be genuine. It can't be just asking for the sake of it. There is a level of respect, to your point, that needs to happen to build up the trust to, you know, then exert the kindness in your conversations that leaders and communicators need to hear and feel in the way you are in that conversation, because that's where the connection is going to be built. And they're going to love the fact that they're asking me great questions. They're connecting with me on this front. And I think it also then empowers that leader. It enables them to utilize that information, to take that, to be able to give it back when listening to others or asking other questions in that curious way. You agree?
100%. And also, you know, the subtitle of the book, Building Great Teams with Trust, Respect, and Kindness. So that comes a lot out of Brene Brown. I read her book, The Power of Vulnerability, and a bunch of other things she's done. But in something that she did, I forget which one it was, she defined love. And she was actually in a room full of people and asked how many people here think love is one of the most important things in their life. And everybody raised their hand. They were like, well, what do you think about it at work? And it's funny, they didn't raise as many hands. And it's this thing that is vital in our lives, but we don't talk about it at work. We don't think it belongs at work. But when you actually break down what love is and you look at what are the factors that actually make up love, there are things like trust. There are things like respect. There are things like kindness. There are things like care, right? So all of these things are infused into the methodology of the lovable leader. So when you're having these conversations and you're fusing those things in, what you are doing is loving the person that you are having the conversation with. You're bringing curiosity in there because you genuinely care about that other person and want to get to know them and want to understand where they're coming from. And you acknowledge them through it, which is part of the way that you build that connection, right? So you mentioned connectosity. There, I like it. A little mashup there. But I think that's the combination of authentic interest in someone else and also authentic acknowledgement of someone else. So when you bring those two things together, how can you not have kindness? How can you not have respect? How can you not have care? Because when you're having a conversation with someone, they're like, yo, you're awesome. That thing you did was really great. Tell me more about that. Why is that so interesting to you? Ah, that's so, like, when you're genuinely in a conversation, someone like that, they're going to feel it. And then they're going to reciprocate in the same way generally.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think it also brings to a really important point that, just as you've said, somewhat even Brene Brown, putting love into the workplace, and that lovable leader highlights how important it is to be that way. It's funny, I'd be curious to know that when you were writing the book, you used it obviously as a guidebook for your wife, which was the gift more or less that you were giving to her. Every author, when they put together a book, there's this happy accident that happens and a gift is given back to them. Jeff, what was the gift that you received from the lovable leader?
I think the obvious one that jumps to mind is just the number of amazing conversations that it's opened for me and the conversations I've gotten to have with people. The validation that like I've written the book and it opens the door for people to really be honest and vulnerable with me and ask questions like, hey, I'm having this thing at work. Like, you know, what do you think I should do here? And the opportunity to serve people like that and people who are in a state where they have people that report to them, they're having friction, the ability to positively impact that situation, I just see the ripple effects of that going out. I will also say that another thing kind of came back to me in it that is, I think, essential, which is to really distinguish and delineate between being a leader and being a manager and seeing that sometimes those things are going to overlap and other times those things are going to be not the same thing. And I realized that I am an excellent leader. I am actually a terrible manager because one of the roles of a manager is consistency and accountability and things that just with this ADHD brain, like they're just not happening. But if you want to talk about making people validated and seen and giving them, you know, the tools so that they can continually succeed, I can do that all day. That's like, that's nothing. It's like drinking water. But the keeping them accountable and checking their task list and the things that go into management, that's tough. And the reason why this is called The Lovable Leader, a handbook for new managers, is because I think that it is actually a lot easier to teach a great manager to be a great leader than it is to teach a great leader to be a great manager. Because I think the skills of management are actually more difficult, and this could just be my own bias, but the feedback that I've gotten from this, the realization reading through it myself, you know, going back through my own material, talking about it, I've realized that I'm not a great manager, that I know how to do the leadership thing pretty well. But it's good to be able to have a more open conversation with people about the differences between those two disciplines.
Yeah. Listeners, if you've been paying attention, he's not a good employee and he is not a good manager. And
neither.
He understands it completely.
Extremely self-aware. I know exactly where I fit in this world.
And by the way, that one of the great things, great leaders know this, is they know what they're good at. And they, more importantly, they know what they're not good at.
Yep.
And empowering and surrounding themselves by those that are better at those things is a key thing. You know, you've probably heard that leadership line in the past, you know, the greatest leaders surround themselves with people that are all smarter than they are, right? Yep. Surround yourself with brilliant people and brilliant things will happen. That's a key belief that's also hard to do. Yes. And I state that because great leaders do have a lot of great qualities that make them excellent in certain areas, and to find the right people around them is challenging. But to empower the people around them to be even better is only setting up a platform where leaders really can thrive. And I think that's pretty awesome. So
yeah, agree.
I love asking guests on the program this question. I'm curious to see where this goes, taking this onto a normal route for Thrive Loud. Look, you've been thriving as a superhero. I mean, my goodness, you're a superhero. My goodness. A coach, a trainer, a speaker, an author and everything. And obviously put together this great book, which means on most days you are thriving. But Jeff, we all have those days where we're a little off our game. We're not quite kicking on all cylinders. Maybe there's a little kryptonite in the room. Maybe it's just a little bit hard to operate. But in those particular moments, when you're having trouble thriving, what practice do you seek, or maybe which individual do you seek out to get yourself back on the thriving track?
Yeah. So there's a couple of reasons why I've noticed I don't thrive. The first is that just a function of ADHD is the way it shows up for me. I don't want to speak for everyone who's on the neurodivergency spectrum, but for me, the days of executive dysfunction versus the days of like hyper focus and productivity, those peaks and valleys can be very difficult to manage. And some days I can pull myself out of that, like cannot get anything started. And other days I simply cannot. When I hit one of those days where I'm kind of stuck, I feel like I'm stuck in quicksand. I found that I really tried to develop routines similar. I often compare it to like a really great free throw shooter in basketball. They always shoot the ball the same way every single time. Like the ones who shoot over 85, 90%, it's textbook every single time. It looks the exact same. So I try to do the same thing as how I can trigger my focus and I can trigger my drive and get into it. So typically that involves some meditative type music. I use an app called brain.fm. It's freaking awesome. Or I'll do the Pomodoro technique, which for someone like me, the hack is I start the Pomodoro technique and then the alarm goes off and I just shut it off and I keep going because it's about getting started. So there's some of my hacks to get started. There are a couple people that I will heavily rely on. And I hate to do it again, but my wife is my muse. She helps me when I'm creatively stuck, but I'll pivot from that. I won't dwell on that any longer, but my business partner in one of my businesses, super productive. She is the yin to my yang business. Like I am chaos and energy and excitement and new ideas, and I build stuff and I have like 8 hours of hyper productivity and then giant gaps of nothing. She is slow, steady, not even slow and steady, but like steady and consistent. She is an incredible manager. My business partner, Sarah, is like the absolute best business partner for me. So when I am feeling stuck, I know sometimes I need her to actually manage me and tell me what it is that I need to be doing in this given moment. So, you know, she knows that I need urgency, for instance. So she'll say, hey, I need you to do this thing like right now, or hey, I need you to do this thing by the end of the day. So she's really good at understanding what are the triggers that I need to get unstuck when I'm having trouble unsticking myself.
I like it. That's awesome. I'm going to save the admin part of the show to the end because we're going to do a big plug for the book here for you. But let's go to Fun Street, which we're going to start off here. I want you to cover all of these because listeners know this. I ask the guests what their all-time favorite movie is, and many times they'll just come up with one answer, or they could do what Jeff did. I'm going to read what you did. Toss up. Tough question. Toss up between Everything Everywhere All at Once and Spider-Man No Way Home.
Yeah.
Okay. So talk about all these. Let's cover them all.
Okay. So Everything Everywhere All at Once is a relatively new movie. It is kind of a superhero movie. I think it's superhero, but it's a multiversal movie. It's the idea of like multiple timelines happening at once. And the main character basically jumps between these different realities. And there's a whole story going on that is action-packed. But the story itself is truly a story about relationships. It's a story about a relationship between a husband and a wife, a mother and a daughter and a father, a mother and the mother main character and her father. So it's a story about family, and it's a story about family not just in one universe, but looking at the decisions that we make and how that changes the trajectory of our life and what it would be like and what makes us happy across all of these universes. And the movie gets me choked up every time I watch it too. So part of the thing about these two movies is that these are two movies that will reliably make me cry. Reliably, like every time.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about Spider-Man No Way Home, which I just rewatched. By the way, I did not notice this, that they had Homecoming, Far From Home, and now No Way Home. Yep. Home. I wonder, it's interesting why that home theme is in all of them. But
yeah.
I saw it recently, as did most of us. Saw it in the theater, by the way, dizzying to see this movie when we saw it. I assume, as the superhero fan that you are, bringing all three Spider-Men together, what was that like for you watching all that dynamic?
It was like watching the entire, like my entire childhood almost, like in one moment, because seeing the first Spider-Man that came out, the Sam Raimi one with Tobey Maguire, was like amazing for me. That was like such a pivotal moment, and I was so into all of those movies. And then when they relaunched with Andrew Garfield, each of them brought something different to the role. And Spider-Man is just a character that resonates like in the depths of my soul. Yeah. So seeing them all come together and seeing that how they always overcome tragedy and trauma, and how they always choose to do the right thing no matter what, and seeing them all come together and seeing their loss and pain and still overcoming that adversity, like basket of tears, just, yeah. You know, really, really pivotal for me to be able to see that happen.
You know, like it's tough to look at, who's the current, Spider-Man,
Tom Holland.
It's tough. Who's, by the way, an unbelievable actor. And his yep. first movie, which was in that crazy disaster in Thailand. I saw that movie when he was a little kid. He was really good in it. That was the first time I think you really got a chance to see him act, because that was crazy stuff to watch, and that emotion and everything yep. was pretty good
yeah.
for these movies, which are meant to be more of the action and all. I mean, half of it is in crazy CGI stuff that we just have no idea what they're doing.
Yeah.
But I got a kick out of all three of them talking about the things like, you know, when they're asking Tobey Maguire's about character, wait, this the yeah. web comes out of it. Where else does it come out of?
Yeah.
freaking hysterical. It was very good because it asked, I think what it did was it took a fan's point of view mm-hmm. in asking the questions that we were all thinking about at one yep. particular point in time. Just
it was a total fan service movie in so many yeah. ways. I mean, that was a gift to people like me.
Yeah, it's great stuff like that. All right, I want to do the speed round of Fun Street here. This is how this works. I'm going to ask you something. I want the first thing that comes to your mind. These are Love things it. That lift you up, motivate you, make you feel good. They basically make you thrive.
All right, let's do it.
Of late, a song that you love to listen to or one that pumps you up?
Oh, God. That's tough. I've been listening to a lot of down-tempo stuff. If I had to listen that was like hyping me up, I would probably...
It doesn't have to be a pump-up. It could be one that pumps you up. A song that you love to listen to. It doesn't have to be a pump-up.
All right, cool. I always enjoy putting on Wow by Post Malone. I just feel like it's like kind of fun.
Favorite food that is not a dessert?
Sushi.
Favorite dessert?
Reese's Peanut Butter Cup.
I love Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. I like them frozen. Do you like them frozen?
I like them either way. I like either chocolate way. And peanut butter together in any form, fashion whatsoever.
I'm a dark chocolate guy, and they do that every now and then. The dark chocolate with peanut butter, that's like off the chart.
They have a peanut butter cup with pretzels in it, and that is like...
Stop.
That's it's crazy. Insane. That's so good. Yeah.
Activity you wish you did more of?
Cooking.
An activity you wish you did less of?
Working.
If I could snap my fingers, Jeff Gibbard could be anywhere in the world. Where is he?
Kyoto.
And you've been, right? Yeah. Yes.
Twice. Awesome. Wait, I get to bring my wife on this one, right?
Yeah. It wasn't like snapping. You get to be there and you can't bring her along.
Yeah.
Last question. Have you ever been on a show or had on your show Brian Fanzo?
No, I haven't.
Because we got to do this. We're going to do this for the ADHD folks, which is Brian is a big proponent of it.
Oh, yeah.
And he pushes it a lot. But that would be a spectacular conversation.
You'd have to play it at half speed.
Yeah, we would have to. To have Jeff and Brian on the same show together would be so much energy. I'm going to suggest it. And maybe
we've actually talked about it. He came to Philly and we met for drinks and we talked about doing it. And I was like, dude, I don't know. We might open a black hole. Like the speed.
That's kind of what I'm thinking. I'm actually thinking we could enter the multiverse if we have Brian and Jeff together on one show. We're going to make it happen. Brian,
I'm into it.
I'm coming to you. Jeff Gibbard. You're the man. Everybody check it out. We'll have a little bit of fun with the graphics for those watching the video here. Definitely make sure to check out, get a copy of Speak Easy at speakeasybook.com. And where can we get The Lovable Leader? Give all the plugs here for us, Brian. Brian, see, I did that for you. Jeff.
It's all good. Wherever books are sold online, there are a few like in-person bookstores here and there that have a copy or two, but it's mostly online. So go to Amazon, give me a 5-star review because that would be super dope. And then everywhere else, buy it, like it, love it. If you want a free copy, email me. I'll give you one. I just want more people to read it, man, because I want to change the world.
I love it. We got The Lovable Leader, the Superhero Institute founder himself, super coach trainer, Jeff Gibbard. Thank you so much for coming on Thrive Lab.
I appreciate you having me.
You got it. Oh, there he is. I was waiting for it. I knew I'd get Spidey on here somehow. And to all the listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.